What up? Today, checking out Birthright TCG. This looks like a good one. I believe it's available now. Where is it available now at? We'll tell you in a second once I open it up where it's available at. But for now, let's roll off. Let's see which one we're gonna open up today. Left will be the evens, rights will be the odds. Well, you know, rather, left will be the odds, rights will be the evens. All right, we got evens. We're going with debut deck 2, Cresselia's Garden. Birthright, Alliance of Lords. Very innovative level up mechanics in this game. Might be kind of fortunate, might be kind of unfortunate that this is around the same time as the what is that game? Battle Spirits is out now again. But the more level up mechanic games, the better if you ask me. All right, scan for rules. Nice if they make it very apparent how you get to the rules. All right, first card. This is a Cresselia the Deer Herder, Lord Cresselia. Once per turn, when a grass minion you control is slain by one of your effects, you may special invoke that minion from your grave rested. Okay, let's read that again. Once it's at level 9, I think you're gonna tick up on a D20. And then you'll start at 0, I believe, or maybe 1. Then every turn you go up 1 level, I believe, or maybe 2 levels every turn. But actually, I guess I'm going to bone up on the rules for the next video. But anyway, on level 9, once per turn, when a grass minion you control is slain by one of your effects, you may special invoke that minion from your grave rested. Sounds like summon. All right, at level 16, gain an additional grass natural invoke each turn. I think this is a game too where you have like 1 action a turn, but don't quote me on that right now though. All right, Forest Bounty, Aegis. When this card is revealed, you may search your deck for up to 1 card named Garden of Sanctity and special invoke it. All right, and that's a 4 strength most likely. Man, yeah, there's no rules necessarily in here. But yeah, we'll just kind of, man, you know what? Let me kind of bone up on this before I get to talking, since there's no rules necessarily in here. I'll be right back. All right, we're going right to the rules. All right, Birthright, Alliance of Lords. Birthright, Alliance of Lords is a competitive card game played by 2 players using a pre-con deck to battle as mighty lords. Command legions of minions, cast powerful charms, and amplify your strategies using augments in order to break through all of the opponent's Aegis cards and deal a lethal blow to their lord. The last lord standing is the victor. Anatomy of a card, Katana, Lady of Sword. Card name, card type and traits under the name. Card element, this denotes the elemental affinity of the card, top left. The card effect. Card's effect contains any special rules of effects it applies to the game. As a general rule, card takes precedent over game rules. If a card's effect would contradict the rules of the game, always follow the rules of the effect shown. And then 3, that's the attack value, bottom right. A card's attack indicates its strength in combat. Attack values are used to determine what is slain during combat between minions or aegises. A card with 0 attack can't exist on the field and it's automatically slain. Types of cards. Minions. It'll say minion right there. Minions represent your troops, the warriors that fight for you. When invoked, they remain on the field and can be used to attack aegis cards or other rested minions. Just rested minions. I mean, wish I had a highlighter to highlight that. But, man, let me write it right here on this deal. Okay. Attack Aegis / rested minions. Okay. Alright, then we got... But minions can't attack the turn they're invoked. Minions can be slain by card effects or if they battle another minion or an Aegis with equal or greater attack. Okay, Summoning Sickness. Yeah, let's write that down. Summon Sickness. Some sick. Alright, Augments. Augments serve as a way to enhance your strategy. Oh yeah, and the website, that is birthrightallianceoflords.com. Okay, augments serve as ways to enhance your strategy. Like minions, they stick around on the field after they're invoked, but they can't battle. They just apply their effects. Augments can sit on the field itself or be attached to a minion to enhance that minion's abilities. Equipment. Predator's Presence. Charm. Or rather, artifacts, not equipment. Artifacts. Charms. Charms represent magic spells or attacks you perform in the game. When invoked, a charm will apply its effects to be put into your grave. Charms are one and done invokes. They don't stick around like minions. Charms, they are sorceries. Okay, Aegises. Aegises are the shields that stand between your lord and defeat. They can't be included in your main deck and instead begin the game in play face down and are revealed as they're attacked. Okay, that's interesting. Aegises are the shields that stand between your lord and defeat. They can't be included in your main deck and instead begin the game face down and are revealed as they're attacked. Okay, that's just the shields. Aegises shields. We'll just put prize cards. Okay, then we have lords. Lords are the commanders of your army. They begin the game in play and can't leave the field or attack. Lords exist to apply their effects and influence the game as the game progresses. Planeswalkers. Alright, to the left is the symbol for Ikor, the power that fuels your lord's birthright. Each player keeps account of the strength of their Ikor, which increases at the start of both players' turns. Ikor ups each player's turn. Okay, cards will have thresholds at which they acquire additional stats or effects. These are denoted in the card's effects text by a number and the Ikor symbol, and only activate at the specified Ikor count or above, so be strategic when you deploy your cards. Most cards allow you to use weaker versions of their effects earlier in the game to help advance your game plan from the start of the game, but saving them for later in the game for greater impact is also a strategy. The field and gameplay zones. Throne, I guess it's where your leader goes. Aegis area, it's your prize cards, your deck, your grave. And above is a diagram of one player's side of the field. A game of birthright, each zone is as such field. This is where the cards are invoked in place. It's where minions and augments remain after they're invoked and where the majority of the action in the game takes place. Aegis, the sub area of the field where your Aegises reside. They're kept in a stack and only the top card of the Aegis area can be attacked or interacted with. Write that down. Attack top Aegis only. Then we have Throne, where your lord is placed. Deck, where decks are placed and remains for the duration of the game. Players can't look at their decks except with effects that allow it. If the deck is ever searched through, it is shuffled immediately after resolving the effect. If a player ever tries to draw a card while their deck is at zero, they automatically lose the game. Grave, this is where cards are placed after they've been used or destroyed. Charms are sent to the grave after they're cast. Yeah, let's just write. Yeah, I already did that. Playing the game. Building a deck. Players play a game of Birthright using decks they construct themselves outside of the game. Below is a list of rules and stipulations regarding building your own deck. A deck must contain 40 to 60 cards consisting of charms, minions, and augments. A deck can't contain more than four of copies of a card. A player must have a Lord card, which can be kept outside of the deck. A player must have seven Aegis cards, which are also kept separate. Players can't include more than two copies of an Aegis. Any Aegis must be the same element as the player's Lord. Setting up the game. A game of Birthright begins with two opposing players. Each player shuffles their deck and Aegis's, then places their decks in the deck zone and their Aegis's face down in the Aegis area with their Lord placed face up on the throne. Players can draw an opening hand of five cards. Your E-core begins at zero, but will increase to one as the first action of the game. Determine which player will go first, at which point the player becomes the active player. In the anatomy of a turn, each turn happens in a series of steps, a mass step. At the very start of each player's turn, all players increase their E-core count on their Lord by one. The active player stands all rested cards they control. Draw step, the active player will draw one card from their deck. The player going first skips this step. Main step, the active player may declare attacks, invoke cards, and activate effects during the game. End step, all effects that say until end of turn cease at this point, and turn changes to being the opponent's turn, at which point they become the active player and repeat these steps. Invoking cards, during each player's main step, they have one natural invoke action they can use to invoke a card from their hand. There are two types of invokes, natural and special. Players get one natural invoke each turn, which allows them to invoke one card from their hand. Some effects will give players an additional invoke actions or may specify only a certain type of natural invoke may be performed. Special invokes are invokes done through card effects and don't consume your natural invoke for the turn. You can perform any number of special invokes during a turn. Battle. During a player's main step, they may choose to declare an attack with the minion they control. This is the minion battles. We get the battle step, and that's it. All right, here we go, flipping through the cards. Right, another one of those forest bounty. Four, I'm taking it. You can only naturally invoke it when you've got your E-core up to four with this one, and then commune with the forest spirits. Foil element, non-foil element, foil whole thing, glass foil. Commune with forest spirits, Aegis. When this card breaks, you may search your deck for up to two deer minion and special invoke it. Nice. Break, I'm sure, is discarded or defeated, if you will. And Enigma Lily, Aegis, grass element, seven E-core cost, I'm taking it. And this is an Aegis. This is the strength of it. So these go into the Aegis deck. You have to have seven of them. And then let me separate these Aegis cards. Okay, yeah, these are Aegis cards. All right, so these will be face down in the prize card, Aegis stack or whatever. And all right, so when this prize card breaks, you get to search your deck for up to two deer minions and special summon invoke it. And Enigma Lily, Aegis card, seven strength or whatever to break this guy. When this card is revealed, slay a minion you control. Now, I didn't read if they're face up. They're probably face down. Then once they're attacked into, then you'll probably just put damage counters on it to signify how many to break it. Or you maybe have to break it all in one, but I'll get to that probably on the second video. When this card is revealed, slay a minion you control. Nice, okay, kind of like Origin Saga, I like that. Okay, when this card is revealed, slay a minion you control. Okay, yeah, that's kind of bad. That's kind of a bad effect. Why would you run that? Because it has a high life, seven. But you could just slay like a low minion you control. And then Cressella's Wraith. Wrath, Aegis, when this card is revealed, you may slay a minion you control. If you do slay a minion, the op controls. 5 strength on that one. And then the last one, Stampede, when this card is revealed, you may special invoke a minion from your hand. This card gains attack equal to that minion's attack until the end of turn. When this card is revealed, you may special invoke a minion from your hand. This card gains attack equal to that minion's attack until the end of the turn. Okay, that's a tricky one. But it has a very low strength though on that one. But when it comes off, you're popping off. Alright, into the main deck cards. Tranquil Deer, this is a one drop minion deer that you can special invoke from that one Aegis. 6 E-Core, when it levels up to 6, whenever you get after basically turn 6. When this card is slain, return it from your grave to your hand. Nice. Okay, you get to recur that guy, but it's only a 1 strength though. I mean, a 1 attack, 1 toughness. And Startled Deer, another 1 strength, but it's a 5 E-Core. When this card is slain, draw 1. Cool. All right, then we got Shimmer Fairy, Minion Fairy, 6 E-Core. Which bumps up every player's upkeep. When you invoke this card, you may slay another minion you control. If you do, another minion you control gets +3 attack until the end of the turn. Another 1 strength fairy. The first one is foil. The last ones are regular. I like that. Our Keeper of the Grove, Minion Druid, 8 E-Core. Once per turn, when you slay a minion you control with one of your effects, you may slay a minion an opponent controls. Excuse me, with attack less than or equal to the attack of your slain minion. Cool. Sacrificing stuff, a lot of sacrificing your own stuff in here. 4 of those. Longleaf the Evergrowing, Minion Elemental Dragon. When you invoke this card, slay a minion you control. And at 10 E-Core, it gets +3 attack. At 16 E-Core, it gets +3 attack. So at 16, it becomes a big 10 attacker. 10 health. Nice. Sword Squall of Spring, Minion Wolf Spirit. When this card attacks, you may slay up to 2 other minions you control. 5 E-Core for each minion slain by this effect. This card gets +3 attack until the end of the turn. And at 10, if 2 or more minions were slain by this effect, stand this card. Okay, now my question is, okay, when this card attacks, yeah, okay. So nice. If 2 or more minions were slain by this effect, stand this card. When this card attacks, you may slay up to 2 other minions you control. Okay, yeah. So with that, yeah, that's just crazy effects right there. Alright, Sword Squall of Spring, Wolf Spirit. Mother Dearest, it's a deer and it's Mother Dearest, like that. 7 E-Core, when this card is slain, gain an additional grass natural invoke this turn. So normally you get to cast one thing a turn, naturally, just normal summon if you will. But then with this one, when Mother Dearest, Bambi's mom, gets murked, then you get to get an extra normal summon. Nice. 1 health on her, so she's not hard to be slain, and you can slay her yourself, being a bad Disney villain. Gift of the Spirits, Charm, deer you control, get +3 attack until the end of the turn. Nice, kind of elf effects right there. Dig that. And then Alms from the Forest, Charm, if you have a Grass Lord, draw 2. Which, of course, you would most likely be running with this card. Maybe you can mix factions. Well, maybe later they'll make multi-faction lords, maybe. Because your Aegises in your Aegis deck have to be the same as your lord. But Alms from the Forest, Charm, if you have a Grass Lord, draw 2. I mean, basically this card is saying there are going to be mixed faction decks. But 16, draw an additional card. Nice. 4 of those. Garden of Sanctity, last card. Augment Field, this is your equipment, your artifact rather. When you invoke this card, reveal the top 5 cards of your deck. Choose up to 1 deer minion from among them and special invoke it. Put the remaining cards on bottom of your deck in any order. 9 E-Core once per turn. When you slay a deer you control with one of your effects, draw 1. Nice. Alright, this was like good quick clean fun right here. All right, easy to understand. Hopefully get this played. Still got a log of stuff to play, but this should be rather easy to get done. All right, come back for debut deck one. This is Eleanor's Menagerie. And hit up that Birthright Alliance of Lords.com. Get you these right now. I think they're going for, I think, 20 bucks a pop, I think. But check them out right now. Boyo Games, like, comment, subscribe, and we're gonna hit them off with a Spock.